Since Thomas Edison's first motion picture was shown in April 1896, Americans have been enamored with the silver screen. Today, film and television rank among the most powerful forces in modern American life as they shape our views about the past and the present. Every day, millions of Americans crowd around their television with their eyes glued to the images displayed on it. According to the American Time Use Survey of 2009 by the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, the average person watches 2.8 hours of television per day. This means that most people spend around 20 hours a week, about a full day, viewing movies, sitcoms, and reality TV. Since the typical American spends one-seventh of their week consuming information from a television, it is no wonder that thought about certain subjects is heavily influenced by the motion picture. Unfortunately, most feature films do not correctly portray historical facts. Take, for example, films from the 20th century that focus on the South during the antebellum era. Instead of portraying accurate history, these films focus on the Southern lost cause. As the Civil War came to a close, the South was not only invaded and conquered, it was utterly destroyed. James M. McPherson, in describing the damages from the war, said Union forces destroyed two-thirds of the assessed value of Southern wealth, two-fifths of the South's livestock, and one-quarter of her white men between the ages of 20 and 40. On top of this, the farm machinery, railroads, and industries were ruined. In order to cope with the humiliation of losing the war and the damages that followed it, Southerners intentionally created a legend or an interpretation of how the war came about and of what happened during it. Pieces of this fable, the Southern Lost Cause, are portrayed in the movies Gone with the Wind, Way Down South, and Jezebel. These films from the late 1930s romanticized the South, playing on the idea of the plantation myth, portraying women as strong and outspoken, and showing slaves as content and happy workers. These lost cause ideas, which have become part of modern popular history due to the influence of film, will be explored and compared to the true history. The old antebellum era South often brings images to mind of grandeur and of a plantation culture. In imagination, it was a land of prosperous plantations and happy Negroes, large white houses with window glass, cultured people who could read and write, music and literature, and a stable economy based on cotton. This vision comes to life in the beginning scenes of Gone with the Wind, the classic Southern film that portrays the antebellum era, the Civil War, and Reconstruction. Starring Vivian Leigh as Scarlett O'Hara and Clark Gable as Rhett Butler, this award-winning film from 1939 is what is often brought to mind when one thinks of the Old South and offers a perfect illustration of the plantation myth. The movie opens to a pastoral scene in antebellum Georgia with a group of black men working contently in the fields and a young black boy running after a chicken before cutting to a tracking shot of Tara, the O'Hara plantation. The plantation has immense, beautiful green fields and a large white house, best described as a manor. The whitewashed manor is immaculately clean and outfitted with Grecian columns and green shutters. White peacocks roam the grounds. The interior is lavishly decorated with crown molding, intricate woodwork, chandeliers, elaborate wallpaper, and plush furniture. The owners of the plantation, the O'Hara family, are sophisticated and genteel. They attend spectacular parties and interact with others of the upper crust. Gentlemen speak of attending college, while black slaves jovially tease their masters and mistresses, bossing them around at times. This idyllic system of living, plantation life, is presented as the norm and is greatly valued. In fact, Scarlett's own father describes his plantation and land as the only thing in the world worth working for, worth fighting for, worth dying for, because it's the only thing that lasts. This perfect plantation culture is further seen in the 1939 musical movie Way Down South, starring Bobby Breen, a young child star from Canada who was well known for his soprano singing voice. This particular movie is set in New Orleans, Louisiana, in the year 1854 on a plantation owned by the Reed family called Bayou Nouvelle. Plantation life, like in Gone with the Wind, is depicted as prosperous and peaceful. The Reeds live in a white manor-like house that is opulent and comfortable, and they enjoy a life of leisure. They readily pursue hobbies like reading or singing, as both Timothy and Tim Jr. demonstrate in the movie multiple times. They are able to afford such a lifestyle due to the near 100 slaves they own, who happily work the day away taking care of the day-to-day operations of the plantation. The real antebellum South stands out in stark contrast to that of these silver screen depictions. During the 18th and 19th centuries, most residents of the South lived in modest homes. A Georgia newspaper editor in 1857 described the typical planter home as a log house half decayed with age, or a frame house with paint, and a yard without a shrub or a flower. These planters typically worked their land themselves, leaving them little time to pursue hobbies or education. In addition, only a small proportion of white males in the South were ever slaveholders. And on the eve of the Civil War in the 1850s, the majority of slaveholders in the South owned 18% of rural landholdings and held 20 or fewer slaves. This is a small number compared to the 67 slaves the Reed family boasted in owning, and the unknown hundreds the O'Haras seemed to have. Now, some planters did indeed own hundreds of enslaved laborers, vast tracts of land, and resided in grand plantation homes outfitted with the latest furnishings fashionable in Europe. However, this was not typical of Southern culture. According to historian John Vlock, less than 1% of all slaveholding families fit this plantation stereotype. Another romanticized image of the Old South is that of the outspoken and headstrong Southern Belle. The Southern Belle is an image of glamour, elegance, and desire, and the model Southern girl. She is impeccably dressed, has a beautiful accent, and represents an ideal of strength and freedom. This image of a Southern Belle is perfectly encapsulated in two different movies from the 1930s, Jezebel and Gone with the Wind. The 1938 movie Jezebel, starring Betty Davis and Henry Fonda, was set in antebellum Louisiana. It premiered at Radio City Music Hall and was advertised with this slogan: "From the picturesque glamour of the Old South, a great actress draws the scarlet portrait of a gorgeous spitfire who lived by the wild desire of her untamed heart. The story of a woman who was loved when she should have been whipped, Jezebel. Pride of the South that loved her. Shame of the man she loved." Betty Davis plays the stubborn, prideful, cunning, and independent Jezebel of the movie, Julie Marsden, who is determined to do anything she sets her mind to. From the very beginning of the movie, she portrays her strong spirit by being willing to go against social norms. She arrives late at her own engagement party, refusing to change out of a riding habit, something quite scandalous for the time. Furthermore, she attempts to control and manipulate her fiancé, Preston, going so far as to force him to take her to the most important ball of the year in a risque, strapless, red dress rather than a white dress like all the women were expected to wear. This act of defiance ultimately causes him to break off the engagement. A year later, he returns with a wife from the North in tow. The knowledge that Preston is a married man does not stop headstrong Julie from trying to convince him that he belongs in the South with her. And at the end of the movie, despite her second rejection, she chooses to take care of a sick Preston, battling yellow fever, though she knows that she will most likely catch the disease. In the closing scenes of the movie, Julie represents perfectly the strong-willed, temptuous Southern Belle with the impulsive, extravagant aspects of Southern personality as she bravely and heroically travels with Preston to the quarantined Lazarette Island, where they most assuredly face a painful death. Now, perhaps the most famous Southern Belle is Scarlett O'Hara from the movie Gone with the Wind. Scarlett is a spoiled, strong-willed young woman who, like Julie Marsden of Jezebel, knows exactly what she wants. At the beginning of the movie, she is enraptured by Ashley Wilkes and is determined to marry him. When she hears he is to marry another, she waits for the opportune time to confront him about this rumor. She sets up the confrontation admirably, wearing a low-cut dress that Mammy, the slave who helps Scarlett get ready, declares declares indecent, saying you can't show your bosom for 3 o'clock. Furthermore, she corners him in the library, closing the door, even though it is unacceptable for them as an unmarried couple to be alone, and proceeds to throw herself at him, declaring her love. Ashley rebukes her, enraging Scarlett. So once again she acts out on her feelings, slaps him, and then throws a vase against the wall once he leaves the room. Throughout the rest of the movie, Scarlett continues to reject propriety, acting on selfish whims. Like Rhett Butler said in the movie, Scarlett is no lady. This Southern Belle silver screen is not a genteel, cultured lady. She is impulsive, strong-willed, and determined. While she can act soft-spoken and flirtatious, underneath the demeanor is a spitfire. The Southern Belle of these movies is a flamboyant image specifically chosen in an effort to alter the attitudes of Southerners by reminding them how wonderful the South was before the war, and is not a correct portrayal of the typical Southern woman during the late 19th century. Antebellum Southern society was patriarchal and very rigid. The feminine ideal was shaped by men and stressed piety, innocence, submissiveness, intuition, compassion, self-sacrifice, and subordination. This social construct limited women in the ways they could react or act. The willfulness and independence that Julie Marsden and Scarlett O'Hara exhibited would simply have not been accepted. The South's leading social theorist, George Fitzhugh, stated, "Women, like children, have but one right in Old South society, and that is the right to protection. The right to protection involved the obligation to obey. If she be obedient, she stands little danger of maltreatment." In addition, women were excluded from public life and were expected to not draw attention. They were restricted to the sphere of the home as well as to the roles that corresponded to their living situation. Grand plantation mistresses, who represented only a tiny proportion, less than 5% of Southern women, merely ran the household, while those on small plantations or family farms retained traditional roles in farming and in household production. Examples of duties included spinning, weaving, sewing, making of lard, keeping of gardens, feeding of poultry, and hoeing of corn. Women at this time simply did not enjoy the life of leisure and freedom portrayed in these movies. Part of the Southern lost cause can also be seen in the portrayal of slaves in 20th century films. In Jezebel and Way Down South, blacks as slaves and whites as masters live together harmoniously, and there is this sense that the system is for the benefit of the slaves, as they need to be taken care of. In Jezebel, there is never an instance of discord between the slaves and their masters. The slaves are portrayed as a simple-minded people who need lots of direction in order to properly complete their work. For example, in a scene before Julie's engagement party, a slave man driving a coach is given explicit instructions by his white mistress on how to mind the coach while she is away. To each instruction she gives, he automatically answers, "Yes'm," and continues to repeat this long after she has stopped talking. The vacant expression on his face and the way he drones on mindlessly make the viewer feel he needs this coaching. The Marsden family seems to have a fondness for their slaves, especially their house butler, who they tenderly refer to as Uncle Cato. The slaves respond to their regard with an affection of their own. Uncle Cato expresses worry for Julie when she is depressed by Preston's calling off of their engagement. Furthermore, when it looks like Julie and Preston are to be reunited, the slaves are overjoyed for her. After spotting Preston's carriage, young slave boys begin to dance around in the driveway. Then, later that night, they gather in the backyard to serenade Julie and Preston. Now, on Way Down South, it is apparent the slaves are very content. They smile and joke around while working and take breaks as they see fit. When the harvest is complete, the slaves break out into celebration, dancing in the now empty fields. The Reeds interact pleasantly with their slaves, discussing building new quarters for them, feeling their wealth should be shared with those who created it. They neither whip their slaves nor sell them. Tim Jr. even considers Gumbo, a young slave close to his age, and Uncle Caton, the black butler, his two best friends. However, this plantation lifestyle is threatened when Timothy Reed dies and the executor of the estate begins to beat the slaves and talk of selling them. Young Tim Jr. and the slaves consider the executor's behavior odd, saying he does not understand how the South operates. Tim Jr. then comes up with a plan to get rid of the executor, bringing the harmonious existence between slaves and their masters back to the plantation. The truth of the matter is, slavery in the antebellum era was much harsher than that presented in these movies. From the stories told in the slave narratives, relations between masters and slaves were often strained. Living in backcountry conditions produced rude, violent, and uncouth masters and mistresses, who had full control over every aspect of a slave's life. Slaves had no rights and were not considered human. They were property and could be sold to pay debts or hired out for extra income. Law gave masters the right to control their slaves by violent means, or dispose of their chattels as they would any commodity. Slaves were mutilated, burned, tortured, and raped. In one narrative, a former slave, Moses Roper, tells of a slaveholder who put his ill-behaved chattels into a barrel into which nails had been driven and rolled them down a steep hill. Others recalled that a runaway slave was brought back and put between the screws of the cotton gin and crushed to death. Raised in such an environment, white children were often also cruel to slaves, and would probably not have befriended them like Tim Jr. did in Way Down South. In the slave narratives of John Thompson, he spoke of his master's son, who would call all the black children to sweep and clear the yard from weeds, in order that he might oversee them. Then, whip in hand, he walked among them and sometimes lashed the poor little creatures until the blood streamed down their backs and limbs. Under such conditions, slaves were not happy and content, as depicted in the films. As seen in these films, Hollywood offers a romanticized version of the antebellum South that depicts Southerners as affluent gentry who live on large plantations. Women were strong-willed and able to freely express themselves, while slaves were genuinely happy with their lot in life. However, as we now know, this was hardly the case. Southern historian Frank L. Alsley, in his recollections of a trip from Chicago to Montgomery in which he traveled with a group of young ladies, stated, "Despite everything which had been said to the contrary, the young ladies had a romantic conception of the sunny South and looked forward to the journey with considerable excitement. They expected to enter a pleasant land of white-columned mansions, green pastures, expansive cotton and tobacco fields where Negroes sang spirituals all the day through." Owsley's story illustrates that these ideas, which come from the Southern rewriting of Civil War history and are perpetuated by modern film, have become part of a popular history and accepted as fact. In an era where movies are more popular than history books, we could easily lose sight of the true history, our actual American heritage.